as you can tell, I'm not in a conventional webinar setting, not in an office room. You may see people coming behind us. This is actually, I'm at the Arizona State Capitol Mall area, presenting live, testing out some of our this webinar platform's features that we can do. And I'll tell you why I'm here in a second, and might make a little bit more sense. So, just to get started on things, let's move along. This is my first time using our mobile platform, so if there's a couple delays, I appreciate your patience there. So, about me and about the organization and what we're all about. My name is Justin McBride. I'm a program manager with DrugFreeAZKids.org. Many of you have joined us before. Some of you, this may be your first time joining us on one of our live webinars. We present these webinars about once a month on a number of topics, ranging anything from drugs like Molly, ecstasy, MDMA, those types of drugs, all the way to heroin, alcohol, tobacco, and a number of other prevention strategies. We also bring people in from different partners that we'll bring in, people that we work with. We've had people from poison control. We've had people from teen law school, just to bring a different look. Basically, with the all supporting our main mission at Drug Free AZ Kids, which is to really prevent and reduce underage drinking and drug use in Arizona. We do that through these webinars, through presentations at schools and community groups, churches, just about anywhere, anywhere they can have us and anywhere our funders will let us go. About me specifically, I am an Arizona native. I'm also a veteran of the United States Marine Corps, an amateur filmmaker, and I really love technology and media, which makes me really excited to be able to present this webinar here today, because I really do love all kinds of media. And another fun fact, presenting live from the Arizona Capitol Mall. The reason I'm here today is actually one of our funders, the Governor's Office of Youth, Faith, and Family, actually sponsors us, many of our programs, including the webinar that I'm bringing you here today. Well, they have us here in partnership with the Parents Commission on Drug Education and Awareness, and they're sponsoring a workshop with, it's me and about maybe 14 other people. We're learning about new curriculum and new ideas for how to educate people in the community about prevention using a different program. So that's why we're here today, but I really wanted to make sure to be able to join you guys with this webinar, because I feel like we have some fantastic information that we'll be able to talk about here. So I'm just taking a little bit of time out of that, that training to be able to bring this to you guys. So today's webinar is really going to focus on these three things. What's the big deal, right? Pop culture and drugs. What does that mean? What's the big deal? What are we talking about? Then we're going to take a look at, why should we care? What can we do? Because a lot of people aren't too sure what to do afterwards. So sometimes we'll do a really good job about talking about what's the big deal, what are we talking about, why should we care? And then we don't really get a time to talk about what we can do. So I really want to take a moment today to talk about that as well. So let's get started with what's the big deal. So what is a big deal? Well, to know what the big deal is, we need to take a look at what pop culture is. Pop culture is the general culture of a society, including the ideas, music, books, and the mass media. So that changes over time, as you're aware, which is kind of cool why I get to be here today talking to you from the Arizona State Capitol. Over 100 years ago, before we were even a state, we were still a territory, technology was a lot different. Media was different. Pop culture was different. The standards, what's considered popular, normal. Some guy standing out here on a mobile platform talking to people all across the country would kind of be weird to people. If you went over 100 years ago. But what's popular, what's normal, things change, especially when it comes to media today. As we know it, it changes quite frequently. So watch that video, and then we're going to come back and we're going to talk about the video, and we're going to kind of dissect different pieces of it.
Let's party!
All of the alcoholics, where you at? Let's go! Hey!
When I'm with you, but I
love it, but I love it. Oh, I can feel my face when I'm with you.
I know you can't meditate. If you're afraid, then you come on with me. And I know what you came here to do. Now bust it open, let me see you get loose. It's going down for real.
Remember, only God could judge ya. Forget the haters, cause somebody loves ya. And everyone in line in the bathroom, trying to get a line in the bathroom. We all so turned up.
And because you're all my friends, and my song is kind of, sort of, about the love of marijuana slash the love of humankind, I brought a little joint if anyone would like it. Anyone?
Justin Bieber, arrested in Miami Beach for DUI, street racing, resisting arrest, and all we can say is...
I think I've had enough. I might get a little drunk. I say what's on my mind. I might do a little time. Cause all of my kindness taken for weakness. Now I'm 4 or 5 seconds from wildin', and we got 3 more days till Friday. I'm just trying to make it back home by Monday morning, I swear.
And I want you to take a moment to kind of process some of what you, those messages you just saw. And the fact that you are here today with the in a webinar called Pop Culture and Drugs, what does this mean for our youth? You're probably going to be a little bit more aware than most people would be just listening to the radio, watching TV, watching music, videos, whatever it may be. But what I want to point out is everything you just saw was from either TV shows, movies, celebrities who are currently relevant. That means they've received awards within the past few years, either on the MTV VMAs, the Video Music Awards, or even more importantly to our young people, the Teen Choice Awards, which, as we know, the Teen Choice Awards is teens' choice. They choose what's important to them in the world of TV, movies, music, athletics, a number of things. So pop culture for teens is really represented well in the Teen Choice Awards. So if you ever want to know what's going on with teens and what they're listening to, what they're watching, what sports they're into, what's in their world, check out the Teen Choice Awards and see who the nominees are. Not just the winners, but who the nominees are, because that's going to be more representative of everything that's going on in their world. So let's take a look at the last video that you would have seen was 4 or 5 seconds with Rihanna, Kanye West, and Paul McCartney. That last video you saw, the reason I like talking about this song is it's one, relevant, something currently in our world today that we can relate to. You probably heard it on the radio, been nominated and received awards on a number of different award shows. But let's take a deeper look at what the message is behind the song. Because at first, I mean, you have Paul McCartney, he's playing the guitar. Rihanna has a great voice. And before I move any more forward with this, I want to make a note that I am not putting down any of the artists or the songs, the TV shows, the movies in the webinar today. I'm merely using them as a talking point to be aware of pop culture that's around us, and then we'll talk later about what we can do. But I'm a lover of music, movies, TV, all media, like I said before. So for me, I don't want to necessarily demonize these. I just want us to be aware of what our kids are listening to, because all of the what you just saw are actually either winners or nominees in the Teen Choice Awards and or the VMAs, the Video Music Awards, from 2015. So very recent. We know Teen Choice Awards and the VMAs are heavily watched by teens and one of the major demographics. So moving forward with 4 or 5 seconds with Rihanna, Kanye West, and Paul McCartney, let's look at some of the lyrics there. She starts off with saying, I've had enough. I might get a little drunk. Okay, obviously there you're going, well, duh, she's talking about alcohol. Well, after that, it's not really that that obvious. It's a little more subtle. keep moving down the lyrics, and then you hear she says, I'm 4 or 5 seconds from Wildin'. Now, Wildin', does anybody have any idea what Wildin' is? If you don't, that's okay. If you do, you can throw it in the chat box. Just the term Wildin'. What does Wildin' really mean? Fight? Okay, fight. I could, yeah. Partying. Fighting, partying. Yeah, actually, you guys are pretty spot on. It's what it really is doing something extreme, going crazy, going all out and doing something the most extreme that you can do. In short, risky behaviors. So she says, Wildin'. So let's continue going down the lyrics a little bit more. And we have 3 more days till Friday. So here's showing an emphasis on the weekend, showing an emphasis on the time that pop culture has already said, that's when we party, right? I'm ready to wild. So I'm just trying to make it back home till Monday morning. Now, all in all, this song isn't super bad. The video's not showing people doing lines of cocaine off of each other and doing shots. But what it is doing is it's starting to normalize some of these behaviors. It's starting to say that, hey, this is what we do. We're pretty much just waiting until we party. We're doing everything that we do now just so we can get to the point so we can party. And then once it's Friday and the weekend is here, well, then we're really free to make whatever choices we want to make, do whatever we want to do, as long as we can make it back home till by Monday morning. But as we know, the consequences of the weekend don't disappear on Monday morning. But that's something that youth aren't necessarily going to consider, because as we look at brain development of young people, while teens may be able to understand what certain consequences are, the prefrontal cortex is not done developing until around the age of 25, which means things like empathy, problem solving, considering consequences, not just knowing the consequences, but considering those consequences are not quite there for them. They're not fully developed yet. So let's move along so we have time to get to some of these others. Miley Cyrus, We Can't Stop. So you saw that there. Well, if you guys didn't notice, she was singing about all kinds of stuff in that, and it's quite an interesting video. And I'm not going to say she's not talented as a singer, as an artist. You know, she definitely has her own style. But when we look at some of these lyrics, she's talking about, I underlined them there, red cups, sweaty bodies everywhere. Well, what do red cups represent? Everybody knows. Even if you're a teenager, if you're an adult, we know what red cups are. It's a party cup. Typically, a red cup is not going to be filled with Powerade or Gatorade or some other kind of beverage or even a soda. Typically, your red cups are at parties we think of as beer, right? So sweaty bodies everywhere. People are partying. Getting back to what Rihanna was saying, getting ready for Wildin', right? So Dancing with Molly. For those of you that aren't aware, Molly is what people sometimes say is a pure form of MDMA. We know that's not necessarily true. It is in the MDMA family, not always the most pure form. Even if it is, doesn't make it good for you by any means. But Molly, ecstasy, MDMA. So Dancing with Molly. Well, pop culture has now given this drug a name. And by giving it a name, it makes it somebody who can be your friend, somebody you can hang out with. Molly's not that intimidating of a name either. It comes from, some people say it comes from the term molecular, or a couple other theories on where the term comes from, where we get Molly. And then she says, this is our house, our rules. Again, talking about independence, freedom, that is really important to our young people. And then if we keep going down, what does it say? Trying to get a line in the bathroom. We all... or it says, wait, everyone waiting in line in the bathroom, trying to get a line in the bathroom. Now, what does that really mean? What's a line? Well, for most of you, you may or may not know, a line doing cocaine, a line of cocaine. You've probably seen them in movies where people will take a credit card or some other flat surface, they'll make a thin line of cocaine or other powder and snort it into their nose. So everybody pretty much saying that this is normal. They're waiting to party, they're waiting for the weekend, this is our house, our rules, everybody's getting turned up here. Again, turned up, that would be drinking, partying, wilded. Same kind of terminology, same kind of meaning, different term, but same kind of undertone here, just a little bit stronger, a little bit more direct for some people, unless you don't know what Molly is, if you don't know what doing a line is, if that's something that's not in your everyday vocabulary. at DrugFreeAZKids.org, we talk a lot about different drugs and alcohol. So for me, when I hear a line, I automatically go to cocaine. That may not be in your in front of mind for you. So keep that in mind. I encourage you, if you hear songs that your kids are listening to, check out the lyrics. If you don't know what some of the words are in those lyrics, go to Urban Dictionary. I don't mean to endorse them from our organization in any way. I just recommend that as a source for you to consider, because they do have some rather colorful definitions on there of some of these words as well. Okay, so now let's keep going down. They actually had a season or two ago, they had a whole episode, had a whole episode there about alcohol. And at first glance, some people said, oh, well, this is great. They're talking about some of the consequences, or they're going to be able to talk about the negative, how sick they get. But in the end, while the whole episode was about alcohol, at the end of the show, they end up throwing up on stage during a performance that's supposed to be about alcohol. And the principal thinks it's part of the show, so they throw up, they get a little sick, they don't get in trouble, nothing really happens. There are no real consequences other than them throwing up. So it kind of goes to show that, hey, yeah, we get in trouble, there's all these little problems, but hey, we're gonna be okay, we'll be fine. Also, Pretty Little Liars, same thing. We see alcohol use in there quite often. Most of the major characters on the show have been drunk at some point in time. But there's really no, for most of them, there's no real consequence in the end, no long-term consequence, no real understanding. And even if there is, it glosses over it, and guess what? The next episode, we're on to somebody else and something more important. So there's not really that big of an emphasis. All these are shows that teens are listening to. Airplane going overhead right now. Apologies if that was it. So let's look at another song. Who knows Can't Feel My Face by The Weeknd? Top in the charts right now. It's been top in the charts for a while. So you're probably aware of it. We just saw the video on there. So Can't Feel My Face. Most people think about this as a girl. He's talking about a girl. Well, let's look at some of the lyrics here. I know she'll be the death of me. The worst is yet to come. We'll both be numb. I can't feel my face. I love it. We can't go without it. Don't worry. All these terms. What this is actually about, and if you start listening to other songs of his by The Weeknd, going back a couple years or even the same year, other songs that are on top in the charts right now too, he actually does talk a lot about sex and drugs. That's kind of what he sings a lot about. And sex and drugs are pretty prevalent in a lot of music that we hear. So it's no surprise, but you say, okay, well, this song, no big deal, right? That's not what this is about. It's not telling my kid to go out and get drunk, go out and smoke. What it is doing, it's normalizing. Come back to normalizing. It's normalizing this type of behavior. Normalizing that, yeah, we know it's bad for us, but you know, we're gonna do it anyway because the reward is better than the possible negative consequences that we can face. And if you know any teenager or yourself, what happens when you get on YouTube and you start clicking around and you watch a video, then you watch another video and they're related? Well, same thing happens here. So as you get more into his more obvious songs about drugs and alcohol and sex, that is gonna be a lot more of a direct message that your kids aren't gonna even have to guess about what they mean. And it just goes back to normalizing. Again, talking a little bit more about normalizing, well, we have Justin Bieber here. Drug possession, vandalism, prohibition, more drugs, fines. Again, what does this come down to, right? We see this. So, okay, so there's some consequences there for him, right? Well, at the end of the day, what is it? Why should we really care about this? Let's move on. Give me just a second here. Sorry about that. Just getting a little caught up. All right. So what is the big deal? Why should we care about it? Well, Justin Bieber just performed at the VMAs, 2015. All these things that are going on, all the things in his life, what's happening, he just performed at the VMAs. That's a pretty big deal. So it's saying that no matter what you go through, give it a year or so, if that, you'll get over it. You'll get beyond it. So it's not necessarily that consequences aren't ever mentioned or addressed. What the issue is that typically they're just glossed over. And at the end of the day, we see celebrities getting a pass sometimes, or maybe we don't see all of the ugly stuff that goes on behind the scenes of rehab and some of those things. We just see, oh, there's a problem, and then magically, boom, they're done. Just like on video games, somebody dies, you hit respawn, you have life again. And you don't see really what the true consequences of those actions are. So that's why we should care. Also, when we look at music and drugs, well, kids, this comes from, I have the source on the bottom there. It's from rehabinternational.org. And every day kids listen to about, on average, 104 minutes of pop music, which over a week is about over 12 hours of music. And of that music, Billboard identifies about one third of popular music as including references to drugs and alcohol. You can see the breakdown there. I'm going to do a follow-up email. I want to email you some of these statistics so you can kind of check it out and get more informed, because we could spend hours talking about almost each one of these sources in these slides. Now, drugs are present in about 50% of music videos on MTV. And this is coming from the research done by the American Academy of Pediatrics, people that care about the health of young people, understanding that there is a correlation between the health of a young person, their well-being, and the media that they watch. Again, not saying that we need to shield kids from every source of media that's out there, but saying that we do need to be aware of what's out there. We need to know what our kids are listening to, because drinking, smoking, and drug use are portrayed on American TV today. Drinking every 22 minutes, 57 minutes for smoking, drug use at least once every 2 hours. And we know that doesn't necessarily just mean TV. That could mean on YouTube, or that could mean YouTube, or they're watching videos, Netflix, and so on. So what? Does it really matter? Our kids are smart, right? So what? That's what I hear from a lot of people say. So what? Not a big deal. Because our kids, they know that that's make-believe. Well, at the end of the day, it comes back to normalizing the behavior. I've mentioned this several times. Perception of risk and social approval are huge when it comes to teens making decisions. If they perceive something to be less risky and they perceive something to be approved of by society, they're going to be much more likely to engage in that type of behavior. And the scary part about that is the younger somebody starts using a substance, the higher likelihood that they will form a dependence on that substance, which we know how what the struggle of addiction can look like for some people. And here, this is just a study that was done by, I believe it was the New York Film Academy. Again, I'll send you all the references. They're on the bottom. Looking at marijuana on TV. And you can kind of see how marijuana on TV and the number of occurrences is kind of trending up at the same way as is use of that substance as well. So to say that there is no link is just not true. We can see the same here with heroin, other than in the 80s, where there was, I guess, a special problem and different things happening. Other than that, you can see the general trend going right along with the number of occurrences of heroin on TV or in film and people using. Now, you might say, oh, well, this could be because there's more people doing it, so more videos about it. I'm not going to say which causes which, but again, it comes back to normalizing. So as we do more movies and we say, oh, this is what's really going on, then it normalizes it and it makes it okay, especially if we don't follow up with some of those conversations with kids. And this is what I'm going to present to you, an easy way for you to remember it. EMT, educate, monitor, talk. What can you do? Educate yourself. Know what your kids are listening to. Know what's popular. Listen to what they're listening to. Watch what they're watching. Know what's in their world. Educate yourself on what those terms mean. Visit our website, DrugFreeAZKids.org. Find out what the terminology is for these drugs. See what's going on. Educate. And then monitor. Keep an eye. What are they watching? So those kind of go hand in hand, right? You got to educate yourself and monitor them. It could be MET. It could be EMT. As long as you're educating and monitoring yourself before you have a conversation. Because the end goal here is to be educated about what they're listening to know what it means, and to know when there's a change, when there's a change in maybe what they're listening to, a change in popular culture, a change in social norms. So that way you can be prepared when you talk about it, and you can bring those experiences. Because we know talking is really important with our kids, especially considering kids who talk with their parents about the dangers of drugs and alcohol are up to 50% less likely to use those substances. So Those are pretty good odds. Does it mean that you talk to your kids and they're never going to have an issue? Or does it mean if you don't talk to your kids, they're guaranteed to have an issue? Those are pretty good odds. Much better than the lottery ticket that you might have bought last week or the scratchers that you bought a couple months ago. Those are good odds. So try it out. But when I say talk, what do I mean with talking with your kids? Well, clearly communicate your expectations. They need to know what the expectations are. And that starts with talking. Talking about what they know. Talking about what you know. Make sure you both have the same information. Because if you think they know certain dangers, maybe they don't. If you assume you know everything that they know, probably wrong, mom and dad. You probably don't. And that's not because you're clueless. That's just because times change. Pop culture changes. And the terminology, the drugs, the substances, what are out there, the way that we access it, Snapchat, Instagram, YouTube, Facebook, no matter what source of media, the sources of your media, it's out there. Know what they're knowing. Talk with them. Know what's out there. And then when you're talking with them, notice I say with, not to them, talk with them about what's acceptable, what's good, what's bad. Get them thinking. Don't teach them what's right and wrong. Teach them to think. Teach them to consider those consequences, because like I said before, it's not just about knowing the consequences, it's about being able to consider those consequences. So if you can come up with some type of policy, it doesn't have to be on paper, but it does help for some families to put that on paper. Come up with some type of a policy, so that way they know what's expected of them, and follow it up with some consequences so that they know. Get their help in deciding what some of the consequences are going to be. Some of the real world natural consequences, maybe things that you're not even going to impose on them, but that will come along with some of your logical consequences. In our workshops, we actually do talk about logical consequences, and I encourage you to check out one of our active parenting workshops where we get into a lot more depth on all of the strategies in setting logical consequences and communicating, cooperating with your kids to ensure that they have the tools they need to make smart choices. So that about wraps us up for our time. I know I probably went over here by about 5 minutes, but I want to refer you to our website, and then I'm going to take some questions. As always, I try to get done in about a half hour. I know we started 5 minutes late, but I will stay on for as long as we need to answer any questions. If you have any questions, please put those in the chat screen. And while I give you guys a chance to do that, I want to talk about some of the resources we have on our website that are going to make it a little bit easier for you. Before I mention accessing our website to become educated about the drugs that are out there, what people are saying. Well, you can also take a look at how to talk with your kids, some of the talking points to start off with. We also have a marijuana talk kit. So if you get asked a question like, well, did you smoke pot when you were younger? Or didn't you do it? Or things like that, and how to address that. Because for certain substances like alcohol and tobacco, those may be used in the home or family members. So it's important to be able to handle those questions when they come up. So when you're watching TV and something comes on, or the radio comes on, and there's a song and they talk about Molly, and you say, oh, do you know what Molly is? Or they're talking about getting drunk, and you talk about the dangers of alcohol. It's important to be prepared to address, well, what about grandpa? Grandpa drinks. Or what about grandma or dad? Or you smoke, mom? You smoke, dad? How are you going to address that? And our website has a wealth of knowledge for you on starting those talking points. What I want to put up here also is my contact information as I continue in answering some questions. Before I start answering those questions, I want to let you know that I'm going to be sending out an email, follow-up email. It's going to have a survey. I'm going to ask you guys to answer a few questions. I think there's 3 or 4 questions on there. Most of them are multiple choice or a yes-no question. If you could please respond to that, it helps us make our program better and helps us get information out to you. Once you reply with that, I'm going to send you information, and I'll probably send this out next week once I get everybody's surveys back on the evaluation. I'm going to send you guys out all this information so you can start looking and clicking around and checking what's relevant. Because when it comes to pop culture, there's way too much to talk about in a half hour, as you guys know. So I want to be able to give you guys the tools that you need to look around and click around. There's studies from the New York Film Academy, the American Academy of Pediatrics, and a number of other sources that I compiled here that I'm going to send out to you. And then if you have questions, you can contact me, because I know it's different in everybody's community. Let's see, as far as, I know we've had some activity going in the chat box, so let's see what we have going on. Yes, Tom Cruise just did that as a lip singing contest with Jimmy Fallon. Yeah, funny thing about that is he actually didn't even realize it. He didn't even realize what the song was about himself. He just thought it was a cool song. How many of us have caught ourselves singing along to a song? Maybe, how about All About That Bass? How many of you guys know the song? You know what I'm talking about. And at first, everybody's singing, oh, All About That Bass, no treble, right? Not really thinking about what bass is. Well, bass is actually referring to somebody's rear, right? Their backside. So it's all about that bass. So talking about, and while some people may say, well, hey, that's a good thing. It's saying it's all about that bass. In that it doesn't require girls to fit into a certain stereotype or be a super thin model looking figure. But at the same time, it's also saying guys like a little more to hold on to at night, still putting their worth on another person, still saying, I require a guy to tell me whether or not I'm worth it, whether or not I'm beautiful. So there, you have to look at things a couple different ways. There's no right or wrong answer necessarily for all of these. It's just important for you to be aware. Be aware of what it's really saying. So you have those real conversations with your kids. Teach them to think. Don't teach them what to listen to and what not to listen to. Teach them to think. Give them the tools that they need to make smart choices, and they'll surprise you. It's like with making healthy choices in food. If kids have healthy options for food, they're more likely to make healthy choices. So give them healthy options. Be that positive influence with some of these maybe not so positive influences that are coming from different sources and media. So that way they can take this all in and think for themselves. Yes, Trish, this presentation will be available to you. I will be sending the presentation along with the slideshow and the all of the references that I use and a ton of different links. So that way you can take this and talk to your kids or take this and put this into a presentation of your own or mix it in with something you're already doing if you're already working with parents or young people, and make it really your own. So if I don't have any other questions, we will go ahead and let you guys go. I want to thank you so much for taking time out of your day to join us during your lunch hour. I'm going to get back into my training, learn some more strategies. That way for our next webinar, I can bring you even more information. Be on the lookout for that email that you will be getting within the next few days and with the evaluation. I look forward to hearing your thoughts and ways that I can improve. You guys have a great day and have fun. We'll see you next time.